Welcome to class. If you guys want to have a seat, we'll start today's lesson on threading.
What? Do it, real quick, do it.
Okay, so during normal 60-degree threading, which we'll touch upon first, you have to have the compound of your lathe set at a 30-degree angle. What the hell? So, Mr. Funny Man, huh? I swear it wasn't me. Wasn't me! I don't want to hear it. Are you gonna tell me that the cat did it? Get down to the principal's office right now. Hello and welcome back to the shop, and we're gonna be doing the beginner video that one on votes, and that's gonna be external threading. This one 22 to 20. So the next video up, I will carry the selection that didn't win over into that, and we'll start a new vote survey on that. So today's video is going to be all about external threading, and we're going to go over a few different common thread forms and just what they look like and their uses. And we're actually going to go over grinding a tool bit to cut the threads, and we're going to be creating a Acme threading tool bit. The 60-degree threading tool bit is pretty much basically the same, but the Acme has got a few different touches I want to show you, and I don't think I see that done a lot. And we're going to cut an external left and right hand thread, normal 60-degree thread, and we're going to cut a external Acme thread, regular right hand thread on that. So let's kind of zoom up on the table here. We'll go show you a couple pictures of some thread forms that you're going to see. Probably the most common, and some tools you're going to need for this video. So let's hop right up over here. Okay, so let's just take a look at your probably top three most common thread forms you're going to see. And number one is going to be a regular 60-degree thread form. And this is your everyday nuts and bolts are going to have this thread form, obviously, unless it's metric. So what that is a 60-degree included angle, so 60 degrees per side. And a little radius at the end. That radius is kind of hard to get on a hand sharpened bit because depending on the actual depth of the thread, that radius is going to change. If you look at carbide inserts, they're usually rated for different thread sizes, and that is the radius in the middle. It's not ridiculously critical to get that radius perfect, but basically when you grind the tool, you want to put just a little bit of a radius on the end just because you don't want a nice sharp point and you don't want that point to snap off. So your normal, like I said, everyday nut and bolt, everyday fastener is going to be 60-degree thread with few exceptions that you're going to run across. So another really common thread that you're going to see is going to be an Acme thread, which is what we're going to be dealing with today. And this is a 29-degree included angle, and that's kind of, you know, your little square. It's got a flat on the top and then a groove. Now these are going to be on anything that has power transmission. Anything that's transmitting power will usually have a Acme thread. Any vise, usually the vise screw or even C-clamps, that's usually an Acme thread on them. So here's two examples of an Acme thread right here. Let me move this out of the way so you can see them. And these are actually the feed screws from the old dials, the old feed screws from my lathe. And you can see they're different pitches. This is a regular right-hand thread. This is for the compound, rather. And this here is a left-hand thread, and this is for the cross slide. And those are both Acme threads. You can see there. You can see how those look. Okay, and your last thread, which is very, very hard to cut on a lathe, so, very hard to cut on a lathe without a die. usually these are cut by threading machines, and that is going to be a pipe taper. So NPT, it's not, NPT stands for National Pipe Taper. It's not National Pipe Thread, it's Pipe Taper. The reason why is those threads are actually tapered. Okay, so if you look at the, look at a fitting and look at a piece of pipe, these threads here are actually tapered slightly. If I can get something straight to get in here. Kind of hard to tell there, but the these threads are slightly tapered. They're, you can cut them on the lathe, they're just very hard. You would have to use some sort of taper attachment or something like that to be able to dial in that taper and get it perfect. Usually, like I said, these are cut by threading machines, which have a set of dies that clamp around the pipe and cut it. And the internal ones are done by a tap. You can probably see the taper a little bit better on this tap there. You can see, let me zoom you in here a little bit. You can probably see the taper of that tap. I think it's something flat against here. You can see the taper of that tap there. If I can get it in frame. Yeah, you can see the taper of that tap a little better right there. So those are going to be probably your most common threads that you're going to come across. And today we're going to concern ourselves with 60-degree threads, standard threads, and Acme threads. So the standard thread that we're going to be cutting today is 7/16 14. Now, we're not going to concern ourselves with measuring any threads, measuring thread depth and thread pitch or anything like that. So basically, we're going to be cutting our threads for, in the case of our 60-degree threads, we're going to be cutting our threads by feel to fit a certain nut. Okay, so whenever you cut threads, unless you have a specified thread pitch diameter, you want to have the mating piece, whether it be a nut, whether it be a fitting, or even the actual housing or whatever. You want to have the mating thread to the thread you're cutting, because you want to do it by feel, and you want to get it to match those the mating thread perfectly. So that's why we're going to be using this nut to test our threads. Now, as far as equipment goes, besides the lathe, obviously, you'll be needing a thread pitch gauge. Just one word about thread pitch gauges. This one is from SPI. It's a 14-034-3. I think this is the 50 leaf one. This has a, goes from 4.5 to something. 4.5 to 84 in 54 leaves or something like that. You want to get a decent one. These SPI ones here, these are actually pretty good, made in Japan. The biggest thing I can say though is you want to make sure whatever one you get has the numbers physically stamped in the leaves and not etched or written on, because that etching and that like kind of, you'll see some that have like ink, like they're printed, that'll wear off in a heartbeat and you won't be able to read them anymore. So just invest the extra, you know, 10-15 bucks and get yourself a decent one. So you're going to need this to first of all figure out what thread you have to cut. Let me get to number 14 so you can see. I can zoom in. You can see that that leaf fits that thread perfectly there. And we're going to be using this to test to make sure we have our lathe set up perfectly to cut that 14 pitch thread. You're also going to need a, another piece of tooling that you'll need is this, a thread gauge, or some people call it a fishtail. And this is going to do three things for you. Number one, it's going to give you a guide to grind your 60-degree threading tool with, and it's also going to give you a guide to make sure that that tool is perfectly perpendicular to your work, and we're going to show all that when we're on the lathe. Now, one thing I want to show you here, and this is a Browning shop, okay? So this is 60 degree threading tool. If you flip it around, see how it says double depth of American National thread? You want one that says that. Some of these say double depth of Sharp V thread. You don't want one of those. You want the one that says American National thread. Now, all these numbers here on this side here are thread pitches. So we're doing a 14, and you see it says 93 thousandths. Now, what that 93 thousandths is double the depth of the actual thread. So it's the basically the amount of material being taken off the whole diameter. So this side plus this side is what that number is. So depending on what your dials read, whether it be direct reading, whether it be diameter reading or radius reading, you'll have to adjust that number accordingly. Now here's the problem. Your compound is going to be set at a 30 degree angle to your work. So you really can't read off the dial and go right to this number, because if you actually see how the tool is moving like this into the workpiece, this number here is that tool feeding straight into the workpiece. So since you're feeding in at an angle, your number is actually going to be slightly more than this because of trig and the angle that it's actually feeding in. You have to feed in slightly more this way to go in further this way, if that makes any sense. So this number you can use as a guide and as a reference, but don't go 100% by it. Go by feel or an actual thread pitch measured over wires, whatever you need to do. But this number right here, what that is really good for is doing the relief groove. If you do your relief groove to this number slightly over, you'll make sure that that tool has clearance completely into that groove throughout the entire depth of the thread. So that's pretty much what I use this number for, is as a general guide and then also a number to do the thread relief depth for. And again, we'll show all that on the lathe. Now another thing here that we're going to need is this is basically the same version of this, but this is for a 29 degree Acme thread. Now same deal with this. It does only two things though. It doesn't have a double depth of anything, doesn't have any numbers, thread numbers on it, but what it'll do is it'll give you a guide to grind the 29 degree threading tool, and it will also, just like this one, give you a guide to get that tool perfectly perpendicular to your work. And the biggest thing is you'll see these numbers and these notches. Now these numbers here correspond to your thread pitch. So you have 7 threads per inch, 3 threads per inch, 2.5 threads per inch, 1¾ threads per inch, however many threads per inch you have. The tip of your threading tool needs to fit into this notch. So you can see the more threads you have, the smaller the tip of the tool is, and the less threads per inch you have, the broader the tool tip. And that what that is going to do is that is going to make basically that deep groove and that space in between the threads. That's kind of what that's for. So depending on what pitch you're cutting, you need to cut your tool to match these notches. And we'll go over all this and everything on the lathe. So first let's go set up on the grinder, and we're actually gonna grind a Acme threading tool. So we're getting ready to start grinding this tool on the grinder, and I've already cleaned my wheels. I've already chewed them up just with the regular, I use a little spiky wheelie deal. And so I have this marked out. The bluing there is more or less for your benefit, just to show you. But that's scribed with the carbide scribe, so that ate into the high-speed steel so I can see it. And all I did was use that as a template and scribed it. So the process for the 60-degree threading tool is the same as the Acme threading tool, the only difference being the angles involved, and we have one more step on the Acme threading tool, whereas we have to put that flat on the tip. But the actual process is the same, so this is covers both of them. So we have our gauge handy, and I'm not worried about the actual nose yet. I'm not worried about the length of the nose.
obviously, if you're doing something really big, you want to make sure the tool that you're using is enough to be able to cover that. So obviously I wouldn't be using this bit for something like one thread per inch. But for something like, you know, three or even all the way up to maybe even, yeah, I would go up to probably about three with this. We're good. So let me just zoom you in just a hair. So you see I have some lines here. Now this is the half angle of our threading angle. So this is half of 29. So this, 14 and a half degrees, and that's just going to give me an eyeball reference to hold this tool at the correct angle for the wheel here. All right, I know I'm going to end up blocking you this way, but there's no easy place to put the camera, so that gives me a visual reference as I'm going to angle the tool bit into the tool. Obviously, I'm going to get it till it fits this really nice, this V slot, and we'll be checking it regularly. Now these tables are tilted about 8 to 10 degrees down. What that's going to do is that's going to, as you're looking at the profile of the bit, give us an angle this way and an angle this way. So it's going to give us relief so that the only piece touching the work and cutting on the work will be that top edge. So that gives us side clearance. So we're going to start in on this, and I'm going to probably hog out most of it on the coarse wheel, and then we'll switch over to the fine. And I have my water handy here. Okay, so we fit really nice in there now. You can see. So now, I'm gonna figure out, I'm gonna do a decent size. So I'm gonna bring this back to four, just so we can, actually, let's do six. So I'm gonna flatten the tip of this until it fits into that notch for number six. Okay, so here's six. This is what we were shooting for. So we fit into six. We fit into six. We're really nice and tight and snug in there. Seven, We're too short. I can see a gap through the bottom of that. And five, we're too loose to fit in there. So right now what I want to do is just going to hone the top, hone the sides, and then we can cut our thread. Okay, so I just wanted to get you a better shot of the tool we just ground. And if we put it in that slot there, you can see we're nice and tight. And we fit. I'll do it this way just so it's easier for me. You fit nice into number six. Number seven, you can see we don't fit in. Okay, I have a gap there. And number five, you can see we're too big. Okay, so we have our workpiece down to our 7/16 diameter minus by about 2/1000 or so. And what we want is a relief groove right in this end. With that relief groove is a place for us to bring our threading tool to stop and then back out, so we don't have to kind of be really fast with it. We have a place where we can actually let this ride and then pull out. Depending on your situation and depending on the depth of the shoulder, the size of your threading tool, you can make that, and your particular application, you can make that thread relief as deep as you want. And for my purposes here, I'm going to make it approximately 2 to 2.5 widths of this parting blade, and that'll give me enough to thread where I need to thread and then back out. So now we want to go in below the actual depth of the thread, and going back to this gauge here, our 14 threads per inch is 93 thousandths of thread depth. Okay, so that's 93 thousandths double depth. So that's the 93 thousandths off the actual diameter of the part. So we're going to round that up to say 100. So we want 50 thousandths here and 50 thousandths here. So depending on what kind of dials you have, you'll have to either feed in 50 thousandths or feed in 100 thousandths. In my case, the direct reading dials, I read off what I take off the diameter, so I'll have to feed in 100 thousandths. So I'll do that so I get a decent thread depth going, a decent relief groove rather. I'm just gonna set zero. Okay, you can see my relief is slightly cone-shaped. That's because of the way this parting blade is ground. I have this ground at an angle to be able to part up against this side of the shoulder without it making a pip on the end. And I just don't want to end up re-grinding it all the time. So that's why you see that. You'll want a regular grooving tool of some sort. I just am lazy and don't want to re-grind the tip of that. So just ignore that little part. Okay, so now we have our threading tool, and like I said, it's regular 60-degree threading tool there. You can see it fits the 60-degree notch on our gauge here. Now, this is ground so that when I put this in a block, that's perfectly straight on with the work. But in case you don't, or in case your grind is off, that's one way to use one of these gauges, is if you take it and put it up against your workpiece like so, you can fit it into the notch like that and adjust your tool post until that lines up perfectly. But like I said, I already know that we're good there. So now what I'm just going to do right now is I'm just going to touch a little bit here on the back. Just chamfer that back edge of the thread and then put a nice healthy chamfer on the front edge of that thread there. Okay? So now I'm going to back you out a little bit and we're going to show you how to set up all the hand wheels here. Okay, so we got you here so you can see both handles and I can kind of explain this. Now you can't see the thread dial which is back here, but we'll go over that in a second. The biggest thing with any threading is you want your compound set at half of the angle of whatever you're threading at. So in our case of the 60 degree thread, we want this at 30 degrees. In the case of the 29 degree Acme thread, we'll want this at 14.5 degrees. And the reason for that is all our infeed into our work, our infeed of our tool into our work is going to be done with our compound. So it's going to be done like this. Now you can see how it moves at an angle like this. And the reason we want to feed in with a compound and we have to have it at the half the threading angle is because it'll be feeding in ahead of our cut. So when we're threading, we'll actually only be taking material off of one side of those threads and only on this edge of our threading tool. And that's what we want. The reason why we want that is because if we were to feed in with our cross slide here, we'd be cutting on both edges of this tool. We'll be putting a lot more chip load on that tool in a high speed bit like this, especially if you're doing smaller threads. If you're doing really deep threads, really, really coarse threads, that's a lot of chip load on this tool, and you can actually break the tool off, or you can jam up the lathe, especially on these smaller ones. It's very important that you kind of try not to feed in with the compound. With the cross slide, I'm sorry. It can be done, yes, but it just puts a lot more pressure on the tool that you really don't need to. Now, as we feed in, as that thread depth gets deeper, we're going to be putting more of a chip load on the outside of this tool. So for our first few passes, we can actually take a decent amount of material because we're not really feeding into the groove of the thread. As we get deeper, we'll be taking a lot bigger, a lot wider of a chip on this outside edge, so our actual infeed will have to be less. Okay, so now to set this up, what I do is make sure we have enough, throw in our compound here, which we do, and just feed in with your cross slide until you get close, okay? And put this handle in a comfortable position. Personally, I like it right there. So we're gonna put it right there, and we're gonna set our collar at zero. The reason why I like it like there is because it's right in front. I can grab it real quick and just give a quick turn back to disengage it. One full turn and we're disengaged from our thread. And then I always know that our dial is going to be in that position when we go back. Now what we want to do is turn the machine on, okay? And we want to feed in with the compound. Until we just touch. So there's our touch. And for reference, we're just gonna set our compound dial at zero. Now, this actually isn't gonna be reading the correct amount taken off because we're actually feeding in at an angle, we're not feeding in straight. Okay, this is a threading dial. If you have a salt bend, you don't have a threading dial, this should be your first purchase. Now, the whole purpose of this is geared, and this runs into the lead screw. And you can see, as we move the carriage, the numbers move, and as we run the lathe, those numbers move. Now, what this will allow us to do is sink our half nuts here, which is this lever right here, to the same spot in the lead screw every time, so that we don't have to shut off the lathe, reverse the lathe, every time, so we can actually engage the half nuts, cut our thread, disengage our half nuts, and come back to the beginning. We don't have to keep our half nuts engaged all the time and keep reversing the lathe back and forth to cut our thread. So, as you can see, as the lathe runs, it turns, okay? And you can see the numbers on here. Now, each lathe is different, but depending on the combo here of what it is and what kind of thread we're cutting will determine what number of line you engage in. And now, we're cutting an even thread on this lathe, so we can grab any line on this dial. Doesn't matter. Odd, if I remember right, is any line. And then there's half threads, which I think are every other line or something like that. I can't really remember off the top of my head. But if you want to kind of stay out of trouble, pick a number and then keep engaging at that number. And then that'll let you make sure that you don't screw up. Some people also put a little line on the number that they're using, so they come to that one every time. Okay? And I'm just going to feed in a couple thousandths on the compound here, and that'll allow me to make a scratch pass. So I'm going to engage. You can see we got a thread. I'm going to come to the edge of that, and then disengage and come out at the same time. Now we can go back to the beginning. I'm going to reset my cross slide back to the same number, back to that zero in the same position. And we're going to check here. We're going to make sure that we have everything set up right, and we are cutting a true 14 pitch thread. All right, so now let me get some lube. So now we can start up, and I'm probably going to take 15 on the compound here. So we'll engage. You see we're right in that same groove. We're going to come to our thread relief, disengage a half nuts, and back off at the same time. Back to the zero setting on our compound. We'll take another 10. Engage. Back off, disengage at the same time. Back to the beginning. Zero on the compound. Take another 10. Engage. Back off, disengage, same time. Back to the beginning. Back to our zero. Whoop. Engage. Back off, disengage, the same time. Okay, so I have you out here just so you can see how the hands and everything works. So, start it up. I'm gonna wait for the number to come around. Disengage, one full turn. Over in the back. Zero. Take a cut. Engage. Disengage. Back. Back to zero. Take a cut, engage. Disengage, back to the beginning, back to our zero. Then take a spring cut, engage. And then back and forth until we see the peaks of the thread start to point up a little bit. What I usually do is, since we have a depth of 93 thousandths there, once I get close, 85 or so, I'll start trying the nut, and then we'll just keep taking a little more and a little more until that nut fits right on. So we'll get to that, and I'll just show you the finished thread. Here's the thread. Let me just get this under here so you can kind of see the thread form a little bit. Okay, you can see it really good down here. And here's the nut. You can see no real rock in it. And threads on there nice. And you can see our thread relief was the correct depth because our threading tool stopped right at that relief. You can see the thread stopping right at that relief. There's no scratch pass, there's no nothing underneath there. So our thread depth was sufficient for this thread. Okay, so all I'm going to do right now is I'm going to part this off here and get rid of this thread, and we'll extend this piece out a little bit, and then we'll just cut our Acme thread on this stock Actually, what we'll do, I'm lying, what we'll do is we'll come out here and we'll do the same thing, and I'll show you real quick how to do a left-hand thread. Okay, now so now we're ready to cut a left-hand thread, and we're set up the same. And we're basically doing the same thing, only with one key difference. That key difference is instead of feeding our carriage from our tailstock towards our headstock, we're going to go from our headstock towards our tailstock. Now, we're not changing the rotation of the lathe at all. We're only changing the direction of feed. So here's where the relief is very important. And what we want to do is, again, come in to a comfortable position on our cross slide here, set our zero, come in with our compound, until we touch. Now by rights, you should have your actual compound swung around to this angle here, so you can feed in with towards the direction that you're feeding. But a lot of cases, if you're too close to the chuck, you can't get your compound swung around that way. So you have two choices. You can either straight in feed, which is actually what I'm going to do here. We'll take a cut at that angle there. So now, from there on, I'm going to feed in with the compound here, or cross side rather. I'm feeding straight in. And you can see how much of a different chip load that looks like. Let's see if I can get a little bit better than that. You can see how bigger and thicker that chip is. And you can see how kind of more crunchy the finish is. So you can see there's our opposite thread pitch. Okay, so we're set up with this, and you can use that gauge just like you can use the other one and make sure that we're on perpendicular to the work. And our biggest thing is that now our compound here is set at only 14.5 degrees to the work. So you can see how much of a difference in the angle that is. But as far as threading goes, exactly the same premise. The only thing is this is going to be a little bit different of a chip load, and it's going to make a different groove. Now, we're not going to any particular size. I'm just showing this. So this really isn't an accurate actual Acme thread. It's just, you know, I'm going to show you how to cut it, that's all. So the same thing here, we're going to get the cross slide at a nice spot. We're doing six threads per inch, so we got to bump this guy up to six. Actually, this this isn't even going to be a true 6 thread per inch Acme thread, because for me to get 6 threads per inch, I have to put on the 42 stud gear, which I really don't want to rearrange all those gears. So this will be for demonstration purposes only, not a true Acme thread. So same idea. Touch with the compound there, back off. I'm gonna take 10. Up. Engage. Back to zero. Back to zero. Now, by rights, this should have a center in it of some sort because it's putting a lot of pressure on there. But you can see how much, as far as tool pressure and everything goes, how much more tool pressure is involved with the Acme thread, how much more material is being removed as compared to the regular 60-degree thread. You have a much broader tip in there, and you can see how much material is moving down in that groove. And you would just do this to the depth you want or the mating part, and it's basically the same threading operation. The biggest difference is the actual tool and the chip load on the tool.
So I hope you guys enjoyed this little demo. I in no way went through every facet of threading. There's also internal threading, which is a whole different animal to begin with, and all different other classes of threading. I didn't even touch on fit or anything like that. Threading is definitely a fundamental operation in the lathe, and once you get the hang of it, it's actually kind of fun. It's a very, very useful thing to do in the lathe. You see me in my videos and stuff use a die in the lathe, and I usually do that for smaller threads or threads that really don't matter, like just a quick handle or screw fit or something like that. You'll see me use a die just to whip it out real quick in one shot. And while those are great, fits and everything else on like that, you can't get a super, super tight, close fit. The only way you're going to be able to do that is to have the mating piece and fit your single-pointed thread to that piece, and you'll get a super, super tight bond, way tighter and way stronger than you can with a die. Also, just dies in general will wear out, and a single-point threading tool, quick little touch-up, and you're done. It's a tricky thing to get the hang of. The biggest thing that I can say when you first start out is get yourself a decent thread relief in there so that you can thread and disengage your half nuts with the bit in that thread relief. So that way there you don't have to be super fast and disengage and back out at the same time. It gets really tricky when you start to, without a thread relief, start to thread right up to a shoulder and you have to pull out right before you hit the shoulder, so you disengage and pull out at the same time. That's way, way trickier, and like I said, the biggest thing when you're first starting out is that thread relief. I can't stress that enough. That'll save you more times than you can even know. Just at first, go slow, put your lathe in back gear, see how it cuts, and just keep going. And then as you get the hang of it, you can go faster and faster and faster and faster. And if you ever forget the thread dial numbers, just pick a number and stick with it. If you do one, just wait for one to come back around and engage on that all the time. And the biggest thing is, the most important thing is that the compound, when you back out, what I tend to do is back out one full turn, and that saves me from screwing that up. That's what people will screw up the most, is they'll back out and then they'll go in, but they'll go in one turn too far or half a turn too far. Having that position at a horizontal level like this is really easy to remember. So when you back out one full turn and then go in one full turn, That's all you need, and that's all you need is 1 foot. And it when you do it by hand, that is kind of muscle memory, is just 1 full turn. And then usually you'll end up 1 full, if your handle's over here, from me looking at it, 1 full turn, most of the times you come back around to 1 full turn and then end up down so that the handle is then this way. So that when you look at it, you know that you aren't on where you were. So you'll back it forward. Now you only go a quarter of a turn. You obviously went more than that. So it's another full revolution right to where you were. So that's another reason why I keep it like that, is just try it, go up to your lathe and try it. Natural reaction of having the handle this way is to back the handle down and then end up with the handle in this position. So that's one way to kind of keep yourself from screwing the compound up coming in and out. And that's it. And like, you're going to screw up and you're going to get loose threads and you're going to overrun your threads. It's just, I mean, I've done it plenty of times, and I've done it on a finished pot where the threading was my last piece to do. And the only reason why I would do the threading first, because if you screw that up, then you can just part the piece off and go on. It was just an awkward part, and the way it was held in the chuck and going back and forth, that had to be the last operation, and I screwed the whole thing up. And that really sucks. But I mean, you're gonna do it and you're gonna scrap a pot, but it's all part of the learning process. So hope you guys enjoyed this video, and we'll see you on the next one. And on the next video, I'll have 2 more choices up for the beginner videos for next month.